Hello and welcome to what is going to be a super colossal nitro-infused podcast session. The ultimate entrepreneur has, as my guest, a man I'm going to call the ultimate performance enhancer. He is a dear friend, a deep, sophisticated thinker, but he's able to take very complex understandings to a very elegant, simplistic form of communication. He is known as the ultimate decision scientist. Alan's big thesis, he teaches people how to turn their top line into their bottom line in 4 years or less. His success stories are about as outrageous as mine. He keeps me on my intellectual mettle because his mind operates in a strata and world that I wish I understood. And I think you're going to have a spirited discussion. Since I am ADD and he is very focused, this ought to be fun. I'm going to take him on an enormous spectrum of Rorschach ink blot type perspectives. Alan, welcome.
Thank you so much, Jay.
This is going to be fun for both of us. And I've been looking forward to this for a long time. So why don't we start by you setting the stage and explaining as quickly but powerfully constraint theory and how it applies in the world of supply, demand, performance, and all the misconceptions people have. And I'm going to give you free rein. I will intervene occasionally, but I love when you go on your very, very focused, just your process. So I'm going to let you go wild. Please do so.
Sure. So Theory of Constraints, or TOC, was introduced by Dr. Eli Goldratt to the market around the mid-1980s in his classical book called The Goal. It's become one of the best sellers of all time. It's sold over 10 million copies already. The theory is really simple in that it explains to you that any complex system, for example, an organization, is at any point in time constrained by very few factors. And that rather than looking for all the many ways that you can improve the organization, find out where the weakest link is or the constraint or the bottleneck of that system. And that provides tremendous focus to any business owner, to any manager, is to look for the few things that can make a big impact rather than the many things that can make a small impact. And of course, there's not many options. If you think about a business that's currently constrained in terms of its performance, there's really just two types of businesses. The one is that you could sell whatever you can produce. That's a really nice business to be in. You can sell whatever you can produce. And for that, the strategy is very simple. How can we produce more? Find out where the capacity bottleneck is on either inside of your organization or maybe on your supply side, and focus everything on trying to be able to produce more. The more common, of course, is the other side, which is you cannot sell whatever you can produce. So there the constraint is in the market. You don't have enough customers. And that becomes more interesting because how do I get more customers is I have to find a way of differentiating myself. And the least often way of differentiating yourself is just focusing on differentiating yourself by a substantial jump in your operational performance. So if you can become much more reliable than your competitors, if you can supply it and shorten lead times, if you, for example, a distributor that's selling to retailers, if you can provide much higher inventory terms, then you can develop a decisive competitive edge and hopefully get you back into the first situation where you can sell much more than what you can produce. So that's in a nutshell what theory of constraints is this understanding that in any complex system, there's always very few things, sometimes even one, that's limiting the performance of the business. And by focusing everything on that, it's a very fast, very reliable way of being able to achieve much, much more than what you thought was possible.
That's fabulous. Okay, so now we understand the basis. So let's talk about some interesting scenarios to talk about how you go at it. I want to give you license because I love it, but I don't think I have mastered it. So I'm not going to be able to express it with its magnitude, and I want you to be able to take over, okay?
So around the early 2000s, we were starting to work with really big organizations. And the obvious question was, if you have a really large organization, where's the constraint? And what was interesting, if you pick an organization like, say, Walmart, you know, they only have a few percentage of the world market. So it's not the size of the market that's limiting their performance. Could it be capacity or land or storage for shops? No, it's not that. They only have a very tiny fraction of it. Could it be cash or supply? No. So we asked ourselves, so if a constraint is really a resource that you don't have enough of to meet the demand, what will satisfy this definition? Where's the ultimate constraint in an organization? And there's only really one resource we could find to satisfy that criteria, which is top management attention. If you just think about it as a thought experiment, the number of things that demand your attention or could benefit from your attention will always exceed your available attention.
That's fascinating.
And that to us was a big insight to say that our focus should be how to ensure that our clients are focusing their limited attention on those few high leverage improvement opportunities. Those things that can give you a high upside if it really works and a small downside if it doesn't. So that was probably the biggest insight in terms of application of theory of constraints. And interestingly enough, at about the same time, completely independently, one of your other friends, Rich Sheffrin, had exactly the same conclusion. And he ended up writing the attention age doctrine that made that claim, that said, if you can figure out how to get the attention of your client and keep it, that's going to provide the ultimate competitive advantage. So it's not just true for us as business owners or managers that our constraint is our limited attention, but it's also true for our clients. So it took the sphere of constraints to another level that says, how do I apply the same techniques that help me squeeze more out of a bottleneck in a factory, get more out of our limited attention? And of course, the biggest thing is stop doing the many things that's not really helping. And that's essentially step one now when we engage with customers, whether it's a government agency or Fortune 500 company, is to list all the things that they are doing that's demanding their scarcest resources, management attention and budget, and it's not really helping, and getting them to stop that, because that will release the attention and budget that they need to focus on those few things that can make a big, big difference.
Give us a litany of what those might be.
So if you think about it, if I have a target to achieve, I want to get from say 10 to 20. And how do I go about doing that? My assumption is normally the more the better. And that's typically when you look at those improvement opportunities, many of them is not going to actually help you to increase the real net profit of the business. They might help you to local optimize. They might help you to improve local performance, improve efficiencies, et cetera, but they don't really help to improve net profit. An example of that, when I was working with a mining company and they had a simple target. They had to get to 12 million tons per year. They were running at about 3 million tons after 4 months. And I had to figure out a way of catching up and getting back to about 1,000 tons a month. And I said, okay, so I wanted you to write down all the things that's currently demanding your attention and budget. And when they got to about 100 initiatives, I stopped them. So it was plastered all over the sides of the conference room. And I said, okay, now I'm going to ask you a really tough question. It's like a little bit below the belt, but I want you to go back to each of those initiatives, whichever ones you put up on the side, and show me how many more tons you will get from that initiative. And you can imagine what happened. There was maybe 3, maximum 5 of the initiatives that had any impact on increasing tons. So the problem was clear. Unless they could meet their target for tons per year, nothing else mattered. And yet the majority of the things that they were doing were not actually helping there. So that's one of the main problems that we see. What wastes people's attention is they keep on doing stuff that's not really helping. The other major thing that we find where people are wasting their limited attention is if you think about where our stress and anxiety are coming from, it's when there's a gap between the target that we've set for ourselves and our actual results. Obviously, this target is somehow based on our potential. And what we find is that people keep on taking actions that increases their potential rather than increasing the results. For a simple example, a company that's got 5% market share, right? So theoretically, they could dramatically increase their performance in terms of increased sales before they start running out of market size. There's 95% of the market that's available. All that they need to do is focus their limited attention to figure out what are the conditions. If I can satisfy them, they can capitalize on the free leverage point that you always share, right? Get customers to pay more, buy more frequently. But what do most of their actions focus on is adding more products and more services and going into new markets. And you want to say to them, listen, you only have 5% of the market. Why are you focusing on increasing your potential? You're just going to increase the expectation gap. That's all that you do. And I think we do it even in the, as individuals. You know, we read more books, we attend more masterclasses and conferences. We keep on adding potential. We don't add results. And what's constraining the results? There must be a bottleneck somewhere. And really focusing on that is the most efficient and effective way of achieving much, much more, much faster.
I love that. I love that. You have great stories. And the first one is your is the one you're talking about, but you didn't get to conclusion because I know the story. Well, but why don't you continue with your mining company for a minute?
Yeah, so the second question that we then said, okay, so now we know what to stop doing. So now we have some available attention and we ended up, of those 100 initiatives, we ended up basically stopping about 50 of them, completely stopping them because there was no real financial benefit of doing them. It's I call them the auditors, they generate tasks, right? They come in, they show you that there's a gap between the benchmark performance and your performance, and that now triggers some kind of initiative to close it. But it's unrelated to the business strategy or the goal. It's just that from a local perspective, it's possible to do better. So should you? No, it's already at the level of good enough. So that first task was getting them to agree what to stop doing will release the available attention and budget. But then the second question was, how the hell do we get back to this 1 million tons a month? Because they were running behind, they were running at about 750. And you imagine yourself standing in front of this group of miners, big guys, you know, they are anxious, they stressed because they don't know how to achieve this. And I called up the first team that's they're responsible for opening up the ore, which is the first step in the mining process. And I said, okay, so how are you going to do that? You at 750 per month at the moment, 750,000 tons a month, you need to get to about 1.25 million to catch up. How are you going to do it? And a guy looked at me and he said, it's bloody impossible. And what I realized at that moment, okay, so I have no domain experience about mining at that stage. Since then, I've learned a bit, but at that stage, there's no magical bullet I can pull out to show them how they can mine dramatically more, almost doubling their capacity. And what I realized was, there was a mental bottleneck in this guy, with this guy. The fact that he was thinking something is impossible doesn't just mean that he's not trying something. It means he's not even trying to think about it. And that to me was an epiphany. And at that moment, all I returned was, I looked him in the eye and I said, it's impossible unless.
Love that.
And I just left that question mark hanging there. Now, since then, we realize what happens is this is a disruptive question, a really disruptive question. Because when you think that something is impossible, all your mind is focused on is finding evidence to justify why you think it's impossible. As soon as you are asked or you ask yourself, it's impossible unless you are forced to think about the conditions that could make the impossible possible. And that was a massive breakthrough. You know, after that awkward period that we were staring at to each other, he said to me, okay, I'll play your bloody game. And he proceeded to tell me what are the conditions that make it currently impossible, that if he was just allowed to break those rules, he could absolutely flood downstream operations with ore. And we essentially just repeated that process in every step of that five-step mining process. We said to them, it's impossible for you to achieve 1.25 million tons because that would give you enough buffer to catch up and stay ahead unless, and they all gave the most beautiful unless conditions. And since then, that's now become one of my techniques that I use with management teams. And it's essentially helping them overcome this mental bottleneck when we believe that something is impossible. Not only we don't even try to do it, but we don't even try to think about doing it.
That's great. I love that. And then, so what happened?
So the end result was that we came up with a list of things that they could do that could dramatically achieve that. We made sure that there was enough buffer in there. We did the financial calculations, and that's often another kind of an obstacle. They say, we can't afford it. We're already running behind budget. So they said, like, you know, a ton is $100, right? Okay, so how many more tons are you going to be able to give? You're going to get, you know, 500,000 more tons per month. That's $50 million per month extra. How much worst case scenario is your cost going to be? And we get them to exaggerate it. And it was like 10 million. We say, okay, what do you think your top management will do? To get 50 million, I have to spend 10 million. And it was approved on the spot. And that was the second kind of an insight, is that when we think about value, it's benefits minus cost. What I want to do is I want to find those improvement objectives where the minimum benefit is still an order of magnitude more than the maximum cost.
I love that.
So the end result was, you know, they were able to achieve their targets. The people weren't fired. They got bonuses, etc. But it left me with this incredibly simple technique. Since then, I've created this podcast series called Impossible Unless. And every episode, we pick a target that somebody thinks is impossible. And we explain why it's considered to be impossible, considering the following. And then we show them the unless conditions.
I love it. Give me a couple of examples and I will encourage people to go there, but tell us some of the bottom lines.
So you mentioned this target that we have, and there's many ways to come up with a very ambitious target. Dr. Eli Goldratt challenged us in the early 2000s, and I still use this, as turning your top line into your bottom line. Like, for most people, unless you're an early startup, that looks to be impossible. And I'll give an example, a company that had about 100 million in sales and 5 million in net profit, right? So for them to take their top line to bottom line means that they would have to increase their net profit from 5 million to $100 million. That's a 20x increase in net profit. And when I shared that target with the CEO, he said to me, look, it's very cute. It's a nice way of stretching the mind, but practically it's impossible for us. Why? He said, because we have 5% of the market, right? So for us to be able to 20X our net profit, it means we'll have to 20X our sales and we'll run out of market. We would need to capture 100% of the market, which is impossible. And as a result, he stopped thinking about it. What I highlighted with this example is one of the most common mistakes executives make, even ones with financial training, is that we assume that our margins are fixed. And that was the mistake he was making. He assumed these margins was fixed. So I said to him, okay, let's think about the reality. Margins are not fixed. You have variable cost and fixed cost. So I want you to go through the income statement with me and we'll do a couple of thought experiments. The biggest leverage point, like you know, is what if we try to achieve that target by just thinking about if we could increase the average selling price of our product or service, right? How much more do we need to increase our price by in order to achieve the full target? And it's pretty simple calculation. So we want to go from 5 million to 100 million. That's 95 million difference. If we can achieve it by increasing our selling price, it means variable cost, fixed cost won't go up. So we really need to just double our price. Our sales will go from 100 to 200 million. Our cost will remain at 95. So we'll get to 105 million in net profit, which gives us 5 million buffer to add capacity to make sure that we really do have enough capacity. And when you are thinking about 2,000% increase in sales, 20%, 20 times, and suddenly you realize if it all comes down to price, it's really just to double the price over a four-year period, right? It doesn't mean we're going to announce the price increase right today. It means we have to figure out a market that's not price sensitive, but time sensitive maybe, and figure out how we can supply much faster to them when they have real emergencies. And in the process, either by focusing on that premium market that's time sensitive or by changing our product mix, we can double our price. And that will get us top line to bottom line much, much faster and much easier than what we ever thought possible. And then of course you can do the same calculations. You can say, what if we can't do it with price? We have to do it with quantity. The only number I need to know is what's your variable cost. If you say your variable cost is 50%, and I want my profit to go up by about 100 million, and I assume that I can do it with existing capacity, it means I need to increase my sales by 200 million to get 100 million to drop to the bottom line. That's still much, much less than what I expected. That's only two times more, and right?
Make a point that I have found, and you probably have too. Most people overstate their incremental or variable cost. But when I get clients, we'll say, okay, what's it cost you to service a sale or a client? And they'll give you an amount. And I'll say, no, that's the amount divided by your current sales. It's not really what it costs to add one more or 10 more sales. As long as you haven't fully utilized capacity, it's only the price of the product, the direct labor, your G&A, but they don't even get that. I don't think a lot of big corporations always get that.
No, you're absolutely right, but it has two major negative consequences. The one is that they totally miss out on these marginal opportunities, right? Just selling a small amount extra will dramatically increase my net profit if I don't have to increase my cost. So in this case with 100 million, if I could increase my sales by just 1%, the only cost that will go up would be my variable cost, which would be 50%. So that's 500,000. The rest of the 500,000 would drop to my bottom line. So I'm going from 5 million to 5.5. That's a 10% increase in net profit for every 1% increase in sales. And I think that it comes from because we publish standard costs, right? So people want to know how much is the total fully absorbed cost. And now that's a fixed the reference point in the mind. This is really how much it costs. No, like you said, it's your sales divided by total cost for last year.
Yeah, it has nothing to do with forward.
No, but there's another devastating impact, which is imagine you're a CEO, you just joined the company, and you ask them for a very simple list. You say to them, I want to see the total cost to produce every product that we currently make. And I want to see next to it in a column how much we can buy this product outside from, right? And I mean, it's not a popularity contest. I'm going to be just brutal. If it costs us $100 to make it and we can buy it for $80, I'm going to shut down those facilities and we'll buy it outside, right? The problem with that is that $100 has only a fraction of the variable cost versus the fixed cost, right? So of that $100, maybe the allocated overhead is maybe $70 and the truly variable cost is $30. So guess what I do when I outsource it? I'm changing my variable cost from $30 to $80.
That's true.
And all the other costs remain because most of the time there's nothing I can do about those.
Wait, that's so interesting. Wow.
That's why many of the outsourcing initiatives end up increasing costs rather than reducing the cost because of that conceptual mistake that we make because we don't differentiate between variable and fixed costs.
I love that. Give us some more stories from your success and also not yours, but some horror stories that people have erroneously made in plunging their businesses to the abyss?
Well, I think the opposite of that is people don't realize how devastating it is when they give away discounts, unnecessary discounts.
Please explain.
So we were working with a business, and to keep the numbers simple, let's just say we stick to the same type of company, about $100 million in sales, or you can make it $100,000 in sales if you've got a much smaller business. And we were looking at, okay, we're going to take this business. We're going to figure out a way of being able to produce 20% more. And as a result, we'll be able to sell it because we've got a competitive advantage. We're going to be doing it more reliably with faster lead times, etc. And we could calculate what that would mean. It would say, we've got 100 million in sales. They've got 5 million net profit. We're going to be increasing sales by 20%. So my variable costs will go up in the same proportion, and the difference will drop to the bottom line, which is 10 million. I'm going to go from $5 to $15 million in net profit within a very short period of time. So I went to the first meeting, and we got the operations team to come through, and they said, you know, they're making these improvements. They think that they could achieve this 20% increase in throughput in the factory. The sales team were confident that they could sell it. But I spoke to the financial team, and I said that there's something in the numbers that's worrying them a little bit. They couldn't figure out what was happening. It turns out what the CEO had done was they were in a tender-based business. So every year they go out on tender. They never got enough tenders to fully fill them up. They either got too many or they got too few. And he wanted to remove this uncertainty. So he went to the two biggest customers that they've got and said, why don't you buy 50% of my capacity? And I said, okay, what do we get in return? And he said, I'll give you a discount because that will give us certainty in terms of demand. And I said, fine, what do you think would be a reasonable discount to get the certainty that we'll give you enough orders to fill up 50% of your capacity? And he offered 20% discount, which in his mind, based on the past salesperson, sounds pretty reasonable.
Yes.
Because he thought, well, the guys are going to increase the throughput in the factory by 20%. So we'll probably make it up in the volume, no problem, but we'll have much more certainty. So if you just do the numbers, what did he do with that business immediately? He would take the sales from 100 down to 80, but the costs would stay the same at 95, right? So he's just taken the business from a $5 million profit to -$15 million loss overnight by just adding that 20% discount. And it's just one of those things where I sit and listen to sales calls. And I think salespeople are not trained to know that in that business, 1% discount is $1 million. That's 20% net profit, right? Every 1% that you're giving away for nothing, you are sacrificing 20% net profit. So that's the other side, is that people give away discounts far too easily. If you're obviously clear about it, this is a new market that you're going to go into. There's no other way to secure the sale apart from offering a discount to see whether they're price sensitive or not. That's a different story. But when somebody phones you up, they want to buy your product and they want to feel special, and they say, so what discount can you give me? It's unbelievable how the salespeople almost immediately will offer them the maximum discount to what they are authorized. And a way that to check that for your listeners or viewers, go and ask your IT team to pull out the distribution by product. Say, here's our list price. I want to know what is the actual price that we are selling this product for. So maybe the list price is $100. Obviously, you will never sell it more than $100. But what you'll find is that there's a very skewed distribution, and the skewness are more towards what's the maximum discount people are allowed to give. If you allow them to give 20% discount, most of the time they'll sell it for $80.
Right.
And And that to me is the other side of it. It's like very small things that can have a massive impact. Just don't give away unnecessary discounts.
I love that. So give us a couple more interesting areas that you have focused on that are just gapingly obvious when you point them out, but profoundly oblivious to most people.
So I work with a lot in the high-tech space. And I remember presenting to one of the biggest high-tech companies on the planet at that stage. And they said, Alan, look, we understand the theory of constraints. Our constraint is very clear. It's in our top developers, right? These are the guys that have to fix the bugs in the existing code, but they also have to develop the new functionality for new code. And these guys are already working 12, 14 hours a day. You can't squeeze more out of them, right? And you're telling us that in most cases, you are wasting your scarcest resources, whether it's management attention or some scarce skill. And I said, how does it apply to us? And I asked them a simple question. I said, I want you to tell me of the functionality that your software contains, how much of that functionality do even your most advanced users use? So for everybody out there, if you think about Excel, if you're a pretty advanced person in Excel, what percentage of its functionality do you think you're actually using? And they came back after some deliberation, and their worst case and best case estimates were somewhere between 10 and 30%.
Wow, okay.
So that means that this incredibly scarce resource is probably wasting about 70% of its capacity developing stuff that nobody will ever use. So for me, that's a kind of an example is when we're thinking about two opportunities that we look for is where are you losing scarce capacity of your constraints, whether that be management attention, whether it be bottleneck capacity or cash, is where are you losing capacity? The second one is what's causing delays in the total flow time. And in both of those, there's normally huge opportunities. You want to find out what's that one thing that's causing most of the problems. So that's one example. And they realized that all the stuff that they're doing with Agile and all of this stuff, even though it would help them to improve local performance, by far the biggest issue is their inability to work much closer with their clients to figure out what the clients really, really need to benefit their business. There's another example I can give you from book publishing.
Sure.
In book publishing, we were called in by one of the largest book publishers in the world. And I said, we've got a big problem. We are wasting about $150 million a year on returns. So about 30 to 40% of every book that's printed comes back for shredding. So the actual wasted printing and distribution cost to get it to retail and then finally come back, and obviously the publisher gives them full credit at the original purchase price, that was about $150 million. So the first thing that we would normally do is to say, could it be that they haven't solved this problem for one of two reasons? One, they're thinking that it's not possible to do better, number one. Number two, they think it's possible to do better, but it's not worth it. So the benefit is not substantial enough to justify all the costs that they would have to incur. So that's what we normally do, is to try and find out what's the real cost of 30 to 40% of books that you are shipping out will come back as a return. And this is where our theory of constraints framework helps, because where is the constraint in a book publishing supply chain? It's obviously the number of customers wanting to buy the book, but where's the operational and logistical constraint is the amount of shelf space and cash that the retailer has got. That will ultimately determine the sell-through rate of the books. And when 30 to 40% of the books that the retailer are holding will ultimately come back, and those are the books that are very low sales velocity, obviously, our simulation models were showing that around 50% of the bookstore shelf space and cash is wasted holding books that will ultimately be returned. And we immediately realized that's why the bookstores are struggling to be viable. You're trying to make money with a bookshop. Imagine you only have half the size of your store and half the cash that you've got available, and yet you have full cost. It's impossible to make a profit. So we knew there was enough money on the table that if we could find a way of reducing the surpluses, we will also be able to help the bookstores hold more inventory. Then the question was, why is it? Is it because of something that the publisher is doing, something that the distributor or the retailer is doing? And what we found out was quite shocking. The first order quantity from the retailer to the publisher, 85% of the time, that first order quantity, and you can imagine what the life cycle of a book is, right? It's not 1 year or 2 years. It could be 20, 30, 40 years. The first order quantity in 85% of the cases is more than the lifetime sale of the book.
Really?
85% of the cases, Jay. That means that you could implement the most advanced algorithms of replenishment, et cetera. You would almost not improve the system at all. So that showed us that the leverage point there was working with the retailers and the distributors to order much smaller quantities, but much more frequently. And so that if you end up not selling, you're not stuck with a lot. But if you do end up selling, you'll get feedback much faster and are then able to ramp up much faster.
That's brilliant. I love that. It's great. Give me one more story and then I'm going to give you a really fascinating challenge if it's technologically doable.
Sure. So we were working with one of the biggest state agencies, and they said that, you know, they were looking at social grants and they were trying to figure out, because they were running behind, there was a backlog building up. And you can imagine in this period, it's terrible when people that deserve the support of government can't get access to it because there's some bureaucracy or bottlenecks. So they ended up finding where the bottleneck was, and they ended up spending money, about $20-30 million, to try to reduce the cycle time of this process from about an hour down to about 5 minutes. And nothing changed. And they couldn't understand why. And they phoned up and said, can you help us understand why? I said, what is the total lead time from the moment that somebody applies for a social grant until they actually get it? And I said, it could be between 30 and about 120 days. So I said to him, so how on earth do you think it would help if you reduce the cycle time of one process from 1 hour down to 5 minutes?
And they
were, you know, they started laughing nervously, but that's one thing I think that's often a miss. There's two big misconceptions in theory of constraints, I think, is the one is that the objective is to debottleneck. When you debottleneck, you essentially are creating a balanced system where all the resources have the same capacity, and that will create chaos and you can't manage that system. You'll be able to get much less out than what you expected because of the constant stopping and starting. The bottleneck is moving all the time. You need one bottleneck. But the second problem is that a bottleneck is only important if it's causing the major delays in the system. So of that 60 to 120 days, even though there was a capacity constraint in the process, that was not what was causing most of the delays. So focusing on what is causing, why is something taking 120 days when the physical touch time is maybe a few minutes or maybe an hour or two?
I love it. What did you find?
Well, we found out that there was the biggest delay was in the process of getting all the data into the system. And it turned out that process could be highly automated. And that could by far reduce that total big delay. We find the same thing in projects. You know, anywhere where you look at the total time it takes to deliver a project, like a construction project, and then you add up the physical time it takes you to do the work. There was a couple of years back, one of the Habitat for Humanity world records was broken when a team used Theory of Constraint to try and get the lead time, you know, for building a complete house down. And they were able to do it in just a couple of hours, right? From literally flat ground until a family can move it. Find it hours or maybe a day or two, and yet the total lead time is weeks or months, et cetera. And to just find out what's causing most of the delay.
Love that. Now let's talk about a couple of things. When we first met, and Alan and I have, we're working on a project, full disclosure, and this is not necessarily intent to provoke people to want to be part of it, but we were drawn to each other because there are similarities, not in our methodology, but in our belief system, and that variability and various factors can be altered and change the whole outcome of performance, whether it's profitability, time, efficiency, opportunity cost, everything. You showed me when we started a couple of, or you shared with me, I can't remember how we did it, but you showed me either on your computer, you had the production where, I can't remember how you did it, but it's a fabulous demonstration. And then you showed me also your app about the congestion on the road. I think both of those are quite profound. Is there a way you can either simulate it, show us, or tell us? Because it's really profound. And then I want you to talk about the fallacy of multitasking, because you have great, great perspective on that.
Sure. So I mentioned this, the reality is when we design systems, it could be a small factory or a whole supply chain, we try to be as efficient as possible. And as a result, we try to make sure that all the resources have just enough capacity to meet the demand. And what we don't realize is that that by itself causes these chaotic systems. And the way that we show it in a simple game is a game that appeared in the goal that Dr. Eli Goldratt wrote, and it's called the dice game. And it's a beautifully simple example. It says, imagine you have a little factory, you have five machines, and each of the machine, the output varies from day to day. And the roll of a dice will determine what the output is for a specific day. So it could vary between 1 and 6 widgets per day, right? You can apply that to a project environment where you can say, you can do between 1 and 6 tasks per day. It varies. Sometimes the tasks are a bit more complicated, et cetera. And the question is, how much can this little factory produce, say in a 20-day period? So you would say, well, if every machine on app can produce between 1 and 6 per day, that gives me an average of 3.5 per day. Multiplied by 20, I should be able to get 70 out after 20 days. And what you do is you get people to play the game. We have a simulator that the viewers or listeners can go to. It's called goldrattsdicegame.com, and they can play the simulation online. But when you play the 20 days, what you notice is happening is that the variability doesn't cancel out.
Explain.
So if the first machine throws a 1, it doesn't matter what the rest throws that day. Only 1 can come out. And if the first 4 machines all get 6s and the poor last machine throws a 1, only 1 can come out. So rather than getting an average of around 3.5, you get about half of that. You get about 1.75. So in the 20 days, rather than producing 70, you get about 35 or 40 out. And that's really interesting because in most real life factories, if you're comparing the design capacity of their bottleneck resources with the actual output of the factory, you often get to 50-60% of that theoretical design capacity. Now, the question is, how do I do more? The most obvious one is, if I want to get 70, that's a commitment I've made to my customers, and I'm only getting 35, after a couple of months of running, I'm going to say, guys, I need another production line, right? I need another 5 machines. Of course, you don't have the time, you don't have the capacity, especially if people say, but I bought you a factory that could do 3.5. You could apply, you know, Toyota production system or lean by adding some Kanban, some buffers in between. That will decouple the system to some degree. You could apply Six Sigma to reduce the variability. But again, that will cost money, take some time. The solution that I developed as part of my PhD is very, very counterintuitive. It uses theory of constraints and says the system is chaotic because it has multiple constraints. There's five machines that are that at any day, the bottleneck can move. Whoever threw a one, that's the bottleneck that day. So how do we improve the system? Is we create a system that has a single bottleneck. So imagine we pick one of those machines, maybe that A, B, C, D, E, we pick the middle one, and we prevent it from throwing sixes. So we reduce its capacity from 1 to 6 to 1 to 5, which means the average will be 3 per day. Now imagine you're in a factory, you're already not meeting the demand, and I come in and I say, what I'm going to do is I'm going to reduce the capacity of one of your machines to create a clear bottleneck. So now the question is, we've just reduced the capacity of one of your machines. So no longer this machine is going to be able to do 3.5, it can only do 3. What do you expect to happen? And we are basically trying to solve two problems. The first one is the one that we don't overcommit. So we can't keep on committing to 70 when we are producing 35, right? It makes us unreliable. But the second one is we want to increase throughput. We want to increase throughput from 35 to higher levels. And if you create this bottleneck, what you have done, say it's in the middle, so it's A, B, C, D, E, we've picked C, we're reducing its capacity down to between 1 and 5, so 3 per day. The machines ahead of it, A and B, has now more capacity than the bottleneck. So that additional half, they can still run at 3.5 per day, will allow them to build up some inventory so that C is never starved of material. And behind it, D and E can still run at 3.5. So they will make sure that the little space behind C is never filled up so that C is never blocked. And if C is never starved or blocked, the output of the system will equal the capacity of the bottleneck. So suddenly you'll be able to run at 3 per day times by 20 is 60 units per 20-day period. So you've gone from 35 down up to 60 by actually creating a bottleneck. And that's really counterintuitive.
That is counterintuitive. I love that. That's brilliant. Now, you may not be able to show it, but I love your example about congestion on the highway. Can you either explain it or even put it on the screen? It doesn't matter.
Yeah, so if you think about a highway, we often have the situation where, you know, in our head, we have to make a commitment. We're going to see an important client and we do the calculations in our mind. We say, I can travel at an average of 60 miles per hour. The client is 30 miles away. And I say, I'll be there in half an hour. And sometimes that trip takes me 20 minutes because I was able to increase my average speed above the 60 miles per hour. But also it could easily take 2 or 3 hours. Yes. And the question is, what makes the difference? Obviously the difference is by how many cars there are on the road. And it's kind of interesting if you map out, if you had to graph it, and you say if the horizontal axis was the number of cars on the road and the vertical axis was the time it would take me to complete 30 miles, what does that shape of the graph actually look like? And what you'll find is there's sort of 3 distinct zones. So the first zone on the left-hand side is whether there's 0 cars on the road or maybe 1,000, it won't make any difference. As long as you adhere to the speed limit, it's going to take you 30 minutes.
Right.
But after that, above that number, whatever that number is, what happens is we are more impacted by delays than what we benefit from early completions over a certain section. So, you know, a truck gets in front of us, it delays us. So our average speed drops maybe to 30 miles per hour, But because of the speed limit, we can't catch up. And now that same 30 minutes can become 45 minutes, etc. So what you'll find in that second segment is the time it takes you to complete the journey are starting to linearly increase from 30 minutes to maybe 35 and then to 40, etc. But there's a third zone, which is essentially when you get to this bumper-to-bumper traffic.
Right.
Where there's just so many cars on the road that suddenly that 30-minute journey can take you 3 hours. And that's kind of that analogy of a traffic system is what we notice most real-life systems are like. There's so much stuff inside of the system that they are in that chaos zone, which is that last zone, where everything takes much, much, much longer than what it should. And counterintuitively, to get the performance to go up, you actually have to dramatically reduce the work in process. Now, practically on a traffic system, we can do that by limiting the access of cars onto the freeway. And from a local perspective, it's very irritating, right? You have to get to your client in 30 minutes time. You make it to the freeway pretty quickly from your home and think, okay, now that I'm on the freeway, it's going to be fair. And then suddenly there's a red light preventing you from getting onto the freeway. And you're going, what? Why are they doing this? Because they're trying to control the number of cars on the freeway, and that allows the traffic to just keep on flowing. So that's a part of where we use the traffic simulation as a way of showing why often the first step in any improvement project is to stop the overproduction part, to stop there's so much work being in the system.
That's so wonderful. Now, let's talk about your philosophy on multitasking, because I love this.
I think, you know, today we know that the science are there, that there is no such thing as multitasking. We cannot do multiple tasks at the same time if the task requires cognition, if they require us to think about it. We can, of course, you know, chew gum and walk, because both the task doesn't require our cognition, but we can't drive and text at the same time. So really what we're doing, the term multitasking came from computers where you were allowing that single CPU to switch between doing a small task for the email system and doing a small task for the spreadsheet and then going back to the email and back to the spreadsheet. Multitasking is good when the saving overall you get is more than the cost of that switching cost. Now, for computers, the switching cost is very small, but for humans, it's large. When we switch tasks, there's a cost, and when we switch projects, there's an even bigger cost. So the question is, why, if all the research is showing that multitasking is a really bad idea, do people keep on using it? And we use simulation to help people understand, first of all, why it's bad and why they are unlikely to stop it. And so the example we always use is you're working on three projects that have 20 tasks each. So that's 60 tasks. Each of them would take you one day. So what commitment are you going to make on these three projects? You'll say it will take us about 60 days to complete the three projects. But that ignores switching cost. So when people are able to simulate that work, and rather than it taking one day of work, it's maybe a second, you know, for a little activity like writing a number on a piece of paper to represent the work, what they find is it doesn't take them 60, it takes them 90 or 120 because of the switching cost. And they make much more errors when we're switching, and they can never be reliable. Whereas if they just focused on doing one thing at a time, focus and finish, they could have done the first project in 20 days, the second one in another 20 days, so finishing at time 40, and the third one, the lowest priority one, in at time 60. But there's also an impact in terms of cash flows. So if you think about doing all three projects at once, you have to take out the cash to start all three projects, and have to wait all the way till the end before you get the cash back as the benefits for your clients. Whereas if you were just focusing and finishing, you would only need the cash to start the first project And then you could use the benefits, the revenue that you get from that to fund the second project, et cetera. So we've known for many years that multitasking is a really bad idea. Multitasking is really not doing multiple things. It's when I'm switching from a high priority task or project to a lower priority task or project when I could have continued to make progress on the higher priority task. And if I can resist that temptation, I can get much more done, much faster, at a much lower cost and much, much better cash flows. And the best way to illustrate this is, like you said, with the law multitasking game. And I'll include a link. We've created one on the web that people can play for free in the cloud to help them see how much of a difference it can make if they can just focus and finish.
That's great, Alan. So now you and I are working on some activities. Why don't you summarize what we're trying to do? Because you do it with more panache and aplomb than I do. And I love listening to you, and you're much clearer communicator, I think, and you got such a great accent. So tell everybody what we're working on.
Yeah. So if you think about most business owners, we've already said they are probably have an attention constraint. They are wasting that constraint resource by trying to do many things rather than trying to do few things. They keep on adding potential to their business rather than focusing on the results. So how do you get them out of that? And a very simple way is to give them a target that in their mind is unrealistic to the point that it might be considered impossible. And that has a number of benefits, which I'll get into just now. But one of the targets that we were thinking about is to say, take your own business, what's your current revenues, and think about in 4 years or less, turning your top line into your bottom line. Do you think that's a realistic target to set? Do you think it's even possible? And essentially what we want to do is we want to share in a webinar with business owners of why, with our combined experience, and we'll invite some other special guests, is why we believe that in most cases, that target, even though it sounds incredibly ambitious to the point that it might be considered to be impossible, is actually not just possible, but highly probable for most businesses out there. So we want to change people's expectation by starting with the goal. The number one problem that we find with entrepreneurs is not that they are too ambitious, it's that their expectations aren't high enough.
I love that.
There's a benefit of that is to say, if you think about any business, how many ways do you think there are to improve your business by 1%? There's many, 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 many ways, right? By 5%, many, many, many ways. How many ways do you think there are to improve your business by 5,000%? And suddenly the opportunities, the possibilities go down dramatically. There might even be just one way of doing that. And that's a massive benefit that we get when we set very ambitious targets for ourselves, is it helps us to focus on that one thing that can give us everything that we want. It's like, if I want to achieve, 10, how do I do it? I can get 10 things that each give me one, or I can take one thing that could give me 20, that even if I'm only 50% successful in execution, I'll still get the 10. I call it buffering for success rather than buffering for failure. Having many small things that I'm working on is buffering for failure. I think that one or two of them might fail, so I keep adding more and more and more, and that builds up my confidence and certainty. Buffering for success means I'm going to go after that one or two opportunities that is so huge that even if I do a pretty terrible job in execution, the potential is enough for me to easily achieve my target. So the idea of our collaboration will be to essentially share with people how we think when we go into an organization. And of course, it's always easier to see it from the outside. Right? I think we will all acknowledge that even in our relationships, you look at somebody else's relationship, it's always much easier to spot the problem from the outside And I think it's simply because, as I mentioned before, these global optima rules that we need is often very counterintuitive from inside the system or from a local perspective. And that's what we are able to provide people with, a framework of thinking completely differently about their business.
And the good news here, and I'm not going to even introduce my methodology, but Alan has given you a profoundly stimulating introduction to a whole world of thinking that is, it is so profoundly obvious, but it's counterintuitive until the logic is explained. And you already know, if you followed me, that I have 30 or 40 elements that are basically, so beyond exponential, but Alan and I and one other gentleman are going to combine our integrative methodologies and synthesize them together. And we're going to help businesses take that and literally challenge themselves to turn their top line into their bottom line in 4 years or less, and probably start making massive progress very rapidly and compound accordingly. And we're going to basically do everything in our power to smash all the perceived ceilings. I love what you said. They're ambitious. Not that they're too ambitious. Their expectations are too low because they think certain things and even certain timelines and certain achievements are impossible for them. And the thing you always say is companies got 1% of the market and they say, I can't grow. It's the most laughable thing in the world. And this is going to be fun when we do it. So for today, I'm going to stop, but I want to do a couple things. Benevolently, Alan has simulation tools. He's got enormous resources he's created. Some are gratis, some are very modest, some are very reasonable. And I want to do everything in my power to encourage anybody this resonated with at a larger level to seek him out. With regard to smaller companies who would never typically be able to afford Alan or myself, we're going to make it very, very affordable. And you should go to the link that's on this. And if you're listening, we'll have it attached. But we're looking forward. And if you want to be part of the beta group, that would be great because we need to work through our methodology anyhow. So it'd be a very reasonable offering because we want you to be a well-rewarded guinea pig more than we need to make a lot from it. Alan has a lot of tools. How do they reach you? How do they avail themselves of your various tools? Because I believe you have such a wonderful piece of the puzzle, and just what you shared today, if they grasp it, that alone, that shift in thinking, that new slant, that flipping your worldview on its side can transform the whole future of entrepreneurs, large, small, professionals. You talk about law firms, accounting firms, clients, and we want to do everything in our power to get them to see that. And I want to do everything in my power, certainly in collaboration with you, but I also want to showcase you because you deserve it. So how do they reach you?
So our company website is just goldrattresearchlabs.com. But as you mentioned, we've developed a whole range of decision support apps. And the ones that I'm particularly proud of are called the Harmony Chain Simulators. They can reach those at harmonyapps.com. We'll include the links for everybody. But these simulators or digital twins are able to now provide us with the technology to answer three really important questions. And we can do that today for retailers, for distributors, manufacturers, project-based companies, even full mines or supply chains. Is firstly, use the simulator to help them understand why they probably are doing the best that they can considering. And what do we mean by considering? Considering the resources that they have and the rules that they're using to manage the resources. So imagine in our project portfolio digital twin, you can upload your full project portfolio into our digital twin with all the resource allocation and the task estimates and variability, et cetera. Press the play button And it will show you probably why you're going to be late, why you're going to get less projects done. That's the first part, is providing you with a deep understanding why you're currently probably doing the best that you can. The second part is, how much better can I do, both operationally and financially? And then the third one is, we provide a full list of all the best practices in that field, where the user can simply check it and say, what if I applied theory of constraints to managing my projects or my supply chain? How much better can I do? So not by adding resources, but by just managing these resources in a different way, like you said, sometimes very counterintuitive way. So we've got a whole range, and they vary from just a couple of dollars all the way from a few thousand dollars that people can use to simulate their full business or even supply chain.
And then if you're large enough, you've got direct services. So this has been, I had a really busy, tough day, and I was fatigued. And now you've amped me, as you always do. You are a great friend, but you're a very, very, very mammoth thinker. And I just love talking to you. Thank you, Alan.
Thank you so much, Jay. It's an absolute privilege to be on this podcast series with you.